Hello and welcome back to Microsoft Mechanics Live. Coming up next, we're going to have a leap. We're going to have a look at the leap forward in SQL Server. It's next leap, and we're going to show you big data capabilities that are now built into SQL with HDFS and Apache Spark, as well as our new approach for data virtualization that allows you to easily integrate data across multiple data sources without even needing to move it or perform ETL. So very cool stuff. And to join me, I've got Travis Wright from the SQL Server team. Give him a big warm welcome.
Hey. Thanks, Jeremy. Glad to be back on the show.
So we've actually done a lot in terms of advances recently with SQL Server, all the way from the platform abstraction layer, the PAL as I like to call it, that enables you to run SQL Server on Linux, to machine learning now built-in box in SQL Server. But with all the data that's out there in big data silos, adding these capabilities that we're doing now in terms of the integration and the data virtualization to SQL Server in a lot of respects, in a lot of ways, is way more useful and even bigger milestone for a lot of people. Can you tell us more about that?
Yeah, we know that integrating data across all these different data silos is hard. The amount of data out there is just enormous anymore. So we really started our journey on data integration back with SQL Server 2016 when we introduced the polybase feature. And that allows you to issue a query to SQL Server, and SQL Server will turn around and then go and query data out of HDFS in like a Cloudera or Hortonworks cluster, for example. And now with SQL Server 2019, we're making it even easier for you to integrate all of your data without having to move it around. And we have a brand new architecture that's designed to give you huge improvements in performance and scalability through caching and parallel processing, as well as having an elastically scalable compute and storage layer for SQL Server.
Very cool. Why don't we explain how this all works architecturally?
All right, sounds good. We do this in two ways. First, we're deeply integrating the SQL Server parallel processing engine with big data components from the open source community, like Spark and HDFS, that are now included in the box with SQL Server. They are a part of SQL Server. That was the big announcement this week. And then secondly, we're going to provide data virtualization connectors for common data sources like Oracle, Teradata, MongoDB, SQL Server, and a generic ODBC connector that make it even easier for you to integrate all of these data sources through SQL Server without having to move your data around through ETL.
Which is really great because big data is now part of SQL Server. Now you don't have to move your data or create separate reporting databases. You can keep it all in place.
Right. So instead of moving your data, transforming it, and creating duplicate data and all that kind of stuff, we've really focused our efforts around data integration on data virtualization now instead of data movement. And that allows you to keep your data in place and yet still be able to access it from a single point with SQL Server. And the nice thing here is that we can really boost the performance of these queries by caching that data and partitioning it across multiple SQL Server instances that really kind of make that query really run fast. And you can even combine data from multiple data sources into this cache. So you can have a join, for example, that goes across some data that's coming into that cache from Oracle and from another SQL and from HDFS, for example.
So it's way more secure because you're not making a persistent copy again of that data. There's less maintenance, you know, fewer ETL jobs. You don't have to do ETL in this case. It's more efficient storage because you're not storing it twice. You know, the data is actually queryable live against the virtual cache. It's not going to go out of freshness or out of date. It's going to stay accurate, right?
Right, exactly. A lot of benefits there. So let's make this real by doing a demo here. I'm going to show you being able to query across multiple data sources here.
All right.
So I'm running here inside of the new Azure Data Studio, which was formerly known as SQL Operations Manager. It's our cross-platform database tool that runs on Mac OS, Windows, and Linux, and it's open source. And here I'm connected to an HPE lab where we have an HPE cluster of machines that has the SQL Server 2019 big data cluster running on it. And I'm going to go to the sales database here, and I'm just going to right-click on that. I'm going to click Create External Table, and this is going to bring up a new wizard that we have that makes it easy for you to do this. I'm just going to select the Oracle type here, and we'll have more types over here over time. And then I can click on Next here. I already have a database master key, so I'm going to skip that. And I'm going to give this a name. And I'm going to pull in the Oracle inventory database from Oracle. And I'm going to grab the server name. And we're going to go into the XE. And then we're going to create a database scope credential here. And we're going to go to system and admin 123. Now what this does is it actually reaches out to that Oracle server, and it discovers the schema inside of that database. And I can then select the table that we want to synchronize over. So we just click on this inventory table here, for example, and we can even select the table. And we can see the schema about that table here. If we want to, we can do some column mapping if we wanted to, and we can maybe even change the name of the table that we want to bring in inside of SQL Server. Click Next, click Create, and now we have an external table that shows up inside of our tables list here. And we can now go and query that table.
And there we go. Very cool, very cool.
Let's move on to creating an external table over HDFS.
OK, let's do it.
To do that, I've got a query here that we can run. And the nice thing about this here is that we have a new query from here. We have a built-in external data source called SQL Storage Pool. And what this does is allows us to query the data inside of HDFS using a SQL Server instance that's actually co-located on every HDFS data node.
Okay.
And it's just built in. You don't have to do anything special. You just define the read schema that you want us to apply to the files that sit in a particular directory or to a particular file.
Got it.
So now we can create this table here. Let's connect to our SQL here. Once we have that table created, we can then just query over that table just like we would any other type of table. And right now what we're doing is we're actually reaching down into HDFS where we have millions of records in these CSV files that sit inside of this directory, mm-hmm. and we're bringing it back up to SQL Server just like you query any other type of table in SQL Server.
And there it is.
There it is.
Very cool. So I can see how this would be hugely valuable, especially when you're dealing with compliance requirements. You don't want to move the data outside of that Oracle database. Or, you know, in this case, you wouldn't have to move any of the data, actually. You'd be able to query it here. It looks local, then, effectively, to SQL. And the nice thing is, you mentioned that Spark and HDFS, they're really in the box. What does it look like, though, and how does that part of it work?
Right. So in that demo, we just saw querying the HDFS that's part of SQL Server.
Yep.
You can also query that data and manipulate it using the Spark engine that's also co-located on that data node. So now you have sort of a shared data lake between SQL and Spark, where you have all that data sitting in HDFS. So now what I want to show you is another demo where we're going to use Azure Data Studio to use notebooks to interact with the Spark runtime.
OK, let's do it.
So first off, I want to show you a notebook experience that's built into Azure Data Studio here. And this is where I can come in and I can write some code in Python or Scala or R. And I can execute that either locally here on my machine using the Python 3 kernel underneath the covers, or I can submit jobs into Spark to have it run there. Now what I'm showing you here is I have this file called artist.txt. It's a CSV file, but it's got some pretty crazy data structures here. It's got a bunch of stuff up here that defines columns, but it's in a weird way. There's a bunch of white spaces.
So it's nearly unstructured, even though it's a CSV.
I mean, this is a mess, right?
Yep.
So we've got this research stuff coming out of Microsoft Research called PROS that allows you to basically make sense of this data by running some code against it. And it will generate code, which you can then run against those types of files and generate a schematized version of it. So to do this, I'm just going to run this PROS library here. This is included inside of Azure Data Studio Notebook Experience and inside of the Spark runtime inside of SQL 2019. It generates this Python code for me that when I go down here and I run this, it'll load this code, or load the data from that file into a data frame. And what did I do wrong here? Oh,
maybe
I missed the pandas
line
at the top.
You got to have the panda.
Got to have the panda.
Otherwise, the panda
man
will be sad.
There we go. Include the panda. There we go.
There it is.
So the data is now structured. We can actually make sense of it, and this makes it easier for SQL Server to read it. Now, the cool thing is I can take this same Python code, and I can go over and inside of the Spark runtime on the top of the HDFS, I can start to apply this to files that are over there. So here's an HDFS browse experience where I can actually browse the HDFS sitting inside of the SQL 2019 Big Data cluster. And we can see that I've got that artist.txt file already there.
Okay.
Now, let's basically go and create a function that will be available to us now inside of Spark. And we can run this same thing over that artist.txt file inside of the Spark cluster. And you can see that it now schematizes all of this. And now I can, if I wanted to, save this back as a CSV file that's in a nice, beautiful format, for example. So this is how you can use something like Spark to do all of your data preparation tasks at scale across all of your Spark infrastructure.
Much, much better. Now that we've prepped the data, we've got it all into a good format, can we analyze it?
Yeah, definitely. That's the whole point of this, right? So we want to be able to get to where we can analyze it. And this is where you want to be able to combine together kind of the different data sets from Oracle, from HDFS, and then feed that into your machine learning services that are built into SQL Server, where you can run Python or R scripts to train your models. You can store that model back inside of SQL Server to operationalize it, and then just as part of a stored procedure, you can actually score your data against that model, maybe as part of a transaction or a batch processing thing there. So let's take a look at another demo here. I've got an e-commerce site sort of scenario here that we're going to look at, and we're going to use machine learning services to predict a pattern of behavior from a click stream of data from somebody visiting our e-commerce site. So let's pivot over and take a look at that now. So on this one, we've got another script here that we've already created ahead of time. Let's bring this up now. So on this one, we're going to, first of all, kick off the model training. So when I kick off the model training, this is going to call this stored procedure here called train book category visitor. It's going to produce a model for me. You can see the output from the production of that model. But let's go take a look at what that actually looks like here. So what this stored procedure does is it defines a SQL query that will go and get some training data out of my database.
Okay.
And then it will call some R script that will be doing some featureization of this using a logistical regression algorithm. And then what we do is once we run this SP execute external script right here, this will execute this R code against the training data we're sending in. And it will produce a model, which we then store inside of the database by inserting it into the sales models table here. Once we've done that, we can then go back out here, and we can do our predictions against this data by using this stored procedure here. You'll see that based upon all the clickstream behavior that we have sitting in HDFS in raw files, we pull that up. We score it against the model, and we can actually predict, based upon somebody's clickstream behavior, whether or not we should suggest to them to go visit the book category, for example. So this allows us to bring together data from our inventory system in Oracle and our HDFS data that has the clickstream data in it in raw format and CSV files, and then feed that into machine learning services inside of SQL Server, produce that model, and now we can score user behavior against it.
Very cool. So we've seen huge architectural advances here in terms of this direction for SQL, having been able to really parse over and analyze big data without having to move it or do a lot of ETL work against it. This is really huge.
Yeah, it's big. Sorry for the pun, but yeah, it's big. This is huge. And this is really like a different dimension for SQL Server to scale into, where you get kind of this caching ability, you get elastic scalability of your performance tiers with compute and storage scalability, all built on top of this native architecture. So it's really, you know, if you think about it, SQL Server is not just a database really anymore. It's really more of like an integration and complete analytics platform that you can use to integrate all this data together.
Right, right. Again, when we think about cross-platform, it's not only about operating SQL inside of Windows or Linux or, you know, multiple operating system types, but also against other databases. So if somebody wants to learn more about these capabilities and really try it and go hands-on for themselves and connect to Oracle and start using Spark and HDFS, where do they learn more? What should they actually be doing right now to get hands-on?
Yeah, so exciting news. We announced the SQL Server 2019 preview this week. You can go and get that for SQL Server on Windows and Linux. And if you're interested in the big data cluster part of it, we encourage you to sign up for this early adoption program at the link here, where we can then assign you to work with a program manager on our team, and then we can really get kind of hands-on with you as you try to evaluate the, you know, big data cluster technology, and we can learn from you kind of how that experience goes.
Awesome. Great to have you on the show again, Travis. Thank you. Thanks for coming, and that's all the time we have for today's show.
Thanks,
everybody.
Goodbye
for now.